Peugeot. Well, episode 18, it's 30 minutes and it's replay to be
your survey of round Australia. Hi, welcome again to the Valley's People. Today in the show we meet two people from the Hunter Valley. Firstly from Maitland, a man who's been so successful in Australia round Australia car rallies that in fact he plots and maps rallies for people around the world. And secondly from Cooks Hill, a lady, and I might say very much a lady, who's auntie to over at least 50,000 people. So I hope you can stay and meet these two people from the Hunter Valley. Thanks for setting some time aside to meet some more of the Valley's people. If you can recall 1953, you can probably recall the Valley going alive when a chemist shop proprietor from High Street, Maitland, won the first, for some while, Round Australia Redex Car Trial. And that's our first guest today, Ken Tubman. Welcome to the Valley's people, Ken. And they certainly were some wild scenes then. I guess maybe because we are inclined in the Valley, as being typically Australian, to say the grass is always greener next door, and I don't suppose anyone really expected somebody from the Hunter Valley to win. And there you were, the winner, with all the kudos. How did that feel?
Oh, that was a marvellous moment in my life. Oh, how wouldn't it be good for anybody?
Right.
But to be so unexpected was the great thing. We didn't expect, although we tried very hard, we didn't expect to come up tops. Almost impossible, I thought.
So you didn't have that feeling of winning when you entered. Why and how did you enter? Because we've got to remember that, 1953, this was the first Round Australia car trial for, well, a generation anyway.
Forever.
Was
that
it really?
Was the first ever, yes.
First ever?
Yes. Well, the reason why I went in, I was very keen on motorsport. I had started rallying a few years beforehand, and this event was given a lot of publicity, and I was very keen to participate in it. And I had a very good friend in Maitland, the captain of the golf club, actually, who was very keen for us to go together. And finally, we went. I had never seen his car before. John actually owned the car. It was a Peugeot 203, which was almost unknown in those days. It was well known in Europe, but not in Australia. They had only just previously come to Australia.
I don't think any of the commentators in 1953 could pronounce it, could they? They were talking about Peugeots and Peugeots.
that's true. Well, the way of pronouncing it is like the French pronounce it, and that's Peugeot. But it's still a fabulous car, and as we found at the end of the rally, that was in absolutely tip-top order, and in fact, even to this day, it's still going, and we virtually got no trouble with the car at all. We broke one piece, which was underneath the car, and that cost us 2 and 6 in those days before the
what, metric. 2 and 6 to go around Australia?
Yeah,
you're having me on, aren't you?
No, really. That was the only thing that we broke or had to replace, yeah. We had a few punctures and that sort of thing. They had to get them redone, but the actual only 2 and 6.
Mechanical repairs,
yes.
2 and 6.
Yes. That was very, very good for such a long and tough rally, because in those days the roads weren't particularly good. Well, they're much better today, of course, but in those days they were particularly rough, and very hard on the cars, and the car stood up to it very, very well.
Apart from owning a chemist shop, you must have given about $1 million worth of publicity to Peugeot. It was almost as good as Redex, wasn't it?
Yes, well, they both did very well out of it, yes.
What really got you going in rallying, Ken? Was it just the outdoor life?
Or? Oh, well, no, I was very, very keen on cars as a young fellow, and I think most young fellows like cars and bikes and that sort of thing, but I was very keen on cars, and I used to, my main hobby was to read up car books and manufacturing books, and to try and find out how cars are built and what makes them tick. And from that I just took on motorsport, which I thought was one of the best sports of the lot. And I went from one thing to another.
Yeah, in those days, though, you were dispensing medicines to the people of Maitland.
That's right.
Keeping them well and alive. And I suppose it was the days before sponsorship, so you had to find the money yourself, did you?
Oh, yes. The very good thing about it was that our complete budget for the trip was £165, which is a bit more today, of course, but that was the whole trip. That included petrol and accommodation and meals, the whole lot, £165.
2 and 6.
And, oh yes, 2 and 6. I think it was included in the 165.
Ken, the success you had then left no doubt in many people's minds worldwide that you were one of the outstanding rally drivers of the world. I know you're a very humble sort of guy, so I'll have to say that. You'll never say it. But this led you to be selected to survey London to Sydney, World Cup rallies through the Sahara Desert and other places. Yeah. Could you tell us about some of those experiences? Firstly, London to Sydney.
Yes, well, actually, that in that case, I was asked to do the survey on that one, mainly because we were a competitor, and we were sponsored, and we had to go from Australia to London by road. We flew to Bombay and met people from Volvo that had driven a Volvo car out to Bombay, and then we drove it back to Gothenburg in Sweden via the rally route. By doing that, of course, you had the knowledge of where you were going, and the worst thing of going in travelling in big long distances is that you've got to go through all these different countries, and that means that it's going through the borders is very, very difficult, and also very hard to find. And of course, we had that prior knowledge, and it was worth its weight in gold, really.
I think most people watching can understand, because they've experienced some of it, albeit just a little of it, but they've experienced some of the conditions of rallying within Australia on country roads and so on. But rallying within the Sahara Desert, now, I don't think I can comprehend that too well. Could you describe that to us?
Well, that was a very, very wonderful experience. That was the London Munich, or they call it London Sahara Munich Rally. That was the second of the World Cup rallies, and we had a crossing from Morocco across the Sahara to the south, and then back from the Kano in Nigeria to Tunis in Tunisia via the Sahara again. We were lucky to do a survey on that particular trip, and I think that one of the reasons why we finished up winning that rally, which was, well, I suppose, even more important than the Radix one,
yes,
was the fact that we did do a survey, and by doing a survey we learnt that the Sahara, while it's all sand everywhere, you can actually pick the different colours of the sand, and by picking the colour you could tell where the going was good and where the going was very hopeless.
Oh, really? What, you get a sort of sand like, well, what, like our beach sand? What is
well,
that?
Well, yes, like our Newcastle beach sand, would be most of the desert would be that sandy, yellowy sort of colour. Then there's a real white one, which is even more treacherous. And then there's a brown one, which was actually the same sand, but in it was millions and millions of little stones. If you looked ahead to as you were going, you could see that were patches of brown sand coming up. And the obvious choice was that you, despite the fact that you were going in a direction, if you could see that to your right or left there was brown sand, well, the idea that you veered via the brown sand so that you stopped on top. If you wanted to stop on the yellow sand or the white sand, you could only do about 200 yards, up to the absolute tops of the distance you could go, doing, say, 70 mile an hour. It would take 200 yards for you to fizzle out and be bogged. And of course, obviously, we didn't want to be bogged in the Sahara, because it took a tremendous amount of time to get a car. Once you bogged a car there, it was almost impossible to get the car out.
You couldn't see a tree to use a winch for.
No. Well, that was one of our, I suppose, in a later rally, that was one of our most wonderful experiences, I think. We had trouble with the one of the sandy rivers, and by the time we got out of the river, we had done our clutch in. And you wouldn't believe that within 200 yards of this river, here was a tree, an old dilapidated tree that had been there for millions of years, and all it had it. But we could just get the engine out of the car, which we had to do to replace the clutch. And this was the only tree, as far as we could see, in all directions. There was no other trees, only this one.
Well, I hope you got down in the sand and prayed to Allah, that's all.
We thank them.
Some of the experiences that you've had around Australia, particularly going back, I think, there seemed to be more colour in the early trials. Is that right, because of the fact that you didn't really know where you were going? It's not navigated like it is today.
Oh, no. No, well, in those days, we did the whole first Redex. We didn't know where we were going at all. We had been given some maps and route charts by people that had been in the areas, but mainly we found out that they were usually wrong, and where you had to go, say, one certain way, we found that when we went that way, it was wrong anyway. I think it made it a very, very good rally, particularly the first one, that everybody, well, except about, I think there were only two or three people that had actually done a survey, but all the rest of the crews, they were all going blind, as we were.
Yes, yes. What's the moment you remember most from that? Is it something to do with the outback, or is it something within a city?
I think the most outstanding thing was the crowd from about Moss Vale, where we came onto the main Sydney road, from Moss Vale back into Sydney. I've never seen, except in overseas rallies, crowds like it in Australia. They had virtually lined the road from Moss Vale to Sydney, which is 70 odd miles, and they were, I'd say, from 4 to 20 people thick the whole way from on both sides, all the way from for the 70 miles, which was unbelievable to think that a rally had got so much attention.
Yes, just think, if you'd taken a bowl along, then you'd have made a profit at 2 and 6 expenses.
Yeah.
Ken, it's been good to talk to you, because very few people know of the behind the scenes Ken Tubman, I think, and the fact that people within the United Kingdom, the United States, recognise your rally driving, and we should be very proud of the efforts you've made on behalf of the Hunter Valley. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, Ron.
I'll be back in just a moment with our next guest. Second guest today is a person that everybody calls Auntie, and that's Auntie Hazel, or Hazel Evans, accompanist to just about everybody, I think, in the Hunter Valley.
Welcome to the Valley's People, Hazel.
Thank you, Ron.
I think so many people have called you Auntie that when you got the BEM off the Queen, did she write Auntie or did she write Hazel?
No, they wrote it was Hazel Evans. And then I had to reply to the city that I would be down there.
Yes.
And Sir Rodan Cutler presented the medal to me. And of course, I felt very short there because I am short. And Sir Rodan was somewhere up the...
Yeah, 6 feet plus.
Yes. But he was very charming.
Yes.
And it was a lovely experience.
Yes, I'm sure it would be, and he deserves to be charming because he gave it to a very charming lady, I might say, who's helped so many people in Hunter Valley for so many years.
Well, I've loved
helping
them.
Did that term auntie worry you at all?
No, not at all.
How did it start?
Well, we used to do a children's show at 2KO, and Mr. Pickover was the director, and he said he didn't like them, the young children calling me Hazel. He said it had to be Auntie Hazel or Miss Evans. So it became Auntie Hazel and he became Uncle Peter.
Yeah, well, these people that called you Auntie then, of course, are ladies now with families of
That's
their own.
Quite
they still
true.
Call you Auntie?
Yes.
Really?
Yes, and they still say, you know, tell their children that I used to play for them at the Victor Ice Cream Show and the Lunchtime Show.
My gosh, I remember the Victor Ice Cream Show.
Yes, you were with me sometimes, Ron.
You remember that theme song?
Yes.
This is the Victor Ice Cream Show.
Oh, yes, that was a very good one. I did have a funny experience about that a little while ago. I was playing at a concert and I got word up from somebody who would, I please play a request. And I said, well, what is it? And they said, the Victor Ice Cream Show. Well, Ron hadn't played it for years and I just had to think. And he said that if I did play it, he would come up and sing it. And it was one of the boys that used to go to the show, and he was the reverend gentleman in that parish.
Oh, really?
So we gave the Acton Victor Ice Cream Show there again.
I think everybody that's been through the media in Newcastle can relate to you very well. And I remember those days, very early days. In fact, perhaps we shouldn't remember. But the very early days when there was community singing going on up and down Hunter Street.
Yes.
And if I remember correctly, the community singing used to start at midday before the film. Then the people would see a film at, the Royal or Strand, wherever it was. And the Newcastle Flyer coming up from Sydney, where all the guest artists used to come, used to arrive at Newcastle Station at about 20 to 12. And they had to get from the Newcastle Station to the theatre in Hunter Street. You were already on stage, the show had started, and the visiting artists from Sydney used to come along and just plonk some music in front of you. You remember that?
Oh, my word.
And people used to marvel, I wonder if they're ever going to trap Hazel. I don't think you've ever been trapped, have you?
Well, only once, I think, Ron, when one of the artists came from Sydney and looked up as the most dreadful manuscript I've ever read. And there was cuts from here to page 4 and then back from page 4 back to page 2. I was turning and shuffling the music all around, you know, but we got through.
Yes.
And we finished together and we started together. So in the middle was a little bit tense.
A sort of direct broadcast without rehearsals at an opera
school.
That was an opera, wasn't it?
An opera, yes. Yeah. It cuts from opera, from Toreador song to, you know, La Bohème, put a bit of that in, you know. But it was well done, I will admit it was well arranged, but the manuscript had that many marks and it was really like a crossword puzzle to try and work it out.
I think at one stage you were just about tearing your hair out, wishing the railways department would bring the flyer in an hour earlier.
I did too.
Yes. The thrill that you must have had, I'm assuming you had early in life, Hazel, when you were legacy queen, is that recalled now?
Yes, I was very thrilled about that. In fact, I'm wearing the watch that I, the original watch that I won from the Legacy Queen. And it was a very, very lovely thrill.
You haven't stopped helping anybody since, have you?
No. I love people.
Do you ever refuse anyone that wants you to accompany them or play for them?
Well, only unless I'm doing something for a previous person. Well, I mean, I always go to the first person that I promise. And I think I've done that all my life.
You had no idea how much you've helped raise for charity in this area?
Oh, I'd hate to say, Ron.
Yeah, I'd love to say, if I could only find out, because I'm sure it runs into hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Oh, I'd say, well, for Legacy, I raised £5,700. And it was a very great thrill.
On this program, just some time ago, we had Father Lavery, who was
a priest at the migrant camp at Greta. They were the days when it was a migrant camp, but you can go back to the days when it was an army camp, can't
That's
you?
That's right. Yeah. It was very good. We used to go up with a crowd and they'd send up requests for me to play Lily Marlene and White Cliffs of Dover, White Christmas, and the good old Daisy, and a few of the only girl in the world. All those sort of things. But
yes, before battle.
Before battle. Yes. It was really lovely.
Yes. Well, what are some of the traumatic moments of an accompanist? What do you worry about most? Because, firstly, could you give me some idea of the people that you have accompanied for, say, in Newcastle, visiting artists included?
Well, I was the late Gladys Montcliffe's Newcastle pianist, and I used to get a card from her every year to my Newcastle pianist.
So you mean she never brought anyone thrilled. With her when she came
no,
here?
No, no.
Always relied on you.
And I had half an hour with her. That was, I think, the only time that I ever had a rehearsal. And we went through three numbers and she said, that's it, I don't want any more. So that was lovely.
Isn't
that beautiful? And then Mr. Blewett used to come from Sydney with the beat, for the band. And I even played for Jack Davey when he came up here. He was very, very good. And he said he was going to play a violin solo night and day. And he said, now you take, I'll start it off. He said, because it's all G strings. I've only got one string on this violin and it was a G string. So he'd take the first two bars and then I'd play the next two bars because it went to B flat. And he'd come back to his two bars in G again. Yeah. So that's how the whole number went right through.
Well, you're educating us all because most of us thought it was a bikini bottom. I see. So Jack Davey played a G string.
Yes, that's all. Yeah. That's all he had on the fiddle.
That's incredible. But what do you worry about most?
Well, I always check that the music's all there because a couple of times I've played numbers and, well, the page is thrown up in the air and I've caught it back. I played for John Shaw. And he was doing the barber song. And in the middle of the page, I went to turn it over and it flipped up into the air. I'm scrambling around looking for the page to come down. We finished together. I missed him out on one bar.
That's the goal of all the company, was to finish together.
Yeah, we finished together.
It's hardly Dixieland, though. I mean, how do you improvise opera when you lose a page?
Well, you just sort of... Well, I knew it was in B flat. And I kept my finger on the B flat, see, until I picked up the other part with the left hand. And then I thought, oh, I hope I put it up the right way. I did.
I have always a funny vision in my mind, because I've watched you work very seriously, and I'll wet the finger and turn the page and get stuck into it. I have this vision one day that you're going to wet the finger, turn the page, and it's not there.
Well, that did happen. And I was playing for, I don't suppose you'll mind me saying who it was.
Not at all, no.
Mr. Errol Collins.
As long as he doesn't mind.
No. Well, we played it many years ago. And when we got to he was playing Charlis. And when we got to the back page, and I just looked, I thought, oh, there's no back page. And I thought, well, I remember this got a, I had a look through it first. And then I remember there was a change of key. And I thought, well, he is hoping that I'd remember that change of key. And of course when he finished he said, well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry, but I just realised Miss Evans didn't have the last page. Well, about a fortnight ago we were doing a show together and he'd played Charlis again and he brought the same copy, and I didn't think to look because his wife plays it too and she has her own copy, and I thought, oh, he's brought Dolan's copy along. When we got to the back page it was missing.
Oh no.
So he said he's going to have it fixed before I play it again.
So.
Yes.
Yes. Although you should just about know it by now.
Well, I mean, if you played it every day, you would. You'd memorise it. But when you don't do it every day, of course, you can't play the same thing every time,
no.
Can
what,
you?
What kind of music do you like, Hazel?
Well, I like all kinds of music because I had to study classical when I first started. But being an accompanist, you've got to play everything. And I like doing it, you know, It's quite enjoyable.
It's been your life, really, hasn't
Everything.
It?
Everything, yes, it has. Yes, it really was.
Do you remember when you first started? Was it just a love for the piano, or were you forced to learn the piano?
No, I think my mother wanted me to learn, because, I suppose being the only girl, she thought it was nice. And, of course, she had a reputation too. She'd used to, she came from Wales, and she won the title of the Welsh Nightingale. She used to sing in at the Sydney of Stedford, and she was lucky enough to win it. So I still have her gold medal at home.
Keep it too.
I will too. I'm very proud of that.
Yes, really keep it.
Yes.
And so you developed into the piano almost out of the Welsh mould, didn't you?
I suppose I did too, Ron. And then when I went, I did learn off a local teacher. And then I went to study with the late Frank Hutchins, and I learned a lot from him. He was very, very good.
Is that the Lindley Evans and Frank
Hutchins?
Yes,
that's the one.
Programs on the ABC for children and
that's
duo
right.
pianist. Yeah.
Well, he used to come up every Wednesday on the flyer, and then go back in the flyer in the afternoon. So it was really lovely. I was very thrilled that I could have the time with him, because he was very good.
Yeah. And when you look back on those, I don't know how many years, I'm going to say when you look back on at least 50 years,
yeah.
I guess, of playing right round the Hunter Valley from one part to the other,
that's
accompanying
right.
just about every artist that's come through the place, many of them have moved on to,
oh, yes.
to opera and to world
that's
status.
Right. Yes.
You find these people remember you, Hazel?
Oh, they do. They really do.
Isn't that nice?
And it's nice to sort of go somewhere and somebody said, oh, my mother remembers you when you were Auntie Hazel. I said, well, that's lovely. But it is lovely, Ron, to be able to look on people like that, you know.
It's some insight into your personality, I guess, to have you say that, you know, isn't
yes.
that lovely? Because other people might resent it or forget it or whatever.
That's right.
But you've got a pretty close bond with...
Well,
so
I
many
love,
people here.
Well, I love people. And I suppose that answers a lot, doesn't it?
Yes. And you love people, and you love the piano.
Yes.
You love raising money for charity.
Yes.
So I guess that just sums up your life in many ways. That's your current work, isn't it?
Yes, it is, Ron. I like it very much.
Well, we like you too, Hazel. Thanks very much, Auntie.
Thank you very much, Ron.
Thanks for joining us on The Valley's People today.
Thank you.
Well, two interesting guests today. Firstly, a rally driver, the winner of the first Round Australia car trial in Australia, Ken Tubman from Maitland. And then we've just met Hazel Evans, of course, a grand accompanist from Cooks Hill, who helps so many people in the Hunter Valley. I hope you can join us in our next program, because we have two more interesting guests to meet from this, the Hunter Valley.